Even if you are old enough, you are forgiven if the name Roland Stewart does not mean anything to you. But if I were to show you his picture, there are some here who, at least people here of my vintage, might remember him. From the 1980 Super Bowl until roughly about 1990, he was a guy who would show up usually at major televised sporting events, though he also showed up at Prince Charles and Diana's wedding, with his trademark rainbow clown wig, holding a placard that read, John 3:16 for the world to see. Or at least that part of the world that owned TVs and cared to be watching that particular event. And if you are one of those people who Googles occasionally the names of people and asks, where are they now? You would discover since 1992, Roland Stewart has been in prison. After he held a maid hostage in a hotel room outside of Los Angeles Airport, where he threatened to shoot down an airplane, albeit with a pistol, from the hotel room. His next parole hearing is in 2017. True story. As far as evangelists go, not the brightest. While his brand of evangelism faded from view shortly after his disappearance, it was, however, revived by football's Heisman Trophy winner Tim Tebow during the 2009 National College Football Championship. In Black Eye, he wrote John 3:16. And apparently, it was the most searched term on Google that day with 90 million hits, if Wikipedia is to be trusted. The next year, the league instituted a new rule banning the use of messages with black eye. It was dubbed and has been dubbed to this day, not surprisingly, the Tim Tebow rule. Notwithstanding the new rule, the promotion of the placard status of John 3:16 seems to have gained new traction post-Tebow. You continue to see it in sporting events, on some surprising personalities, some subliminal merchandise, wow, and of course, the occasional inspiring road sign. Now, one may well ask, what are people hoping will happen with such publicity? Assuming our John 3:16 evangelists are not in it for personal attention and are genuinely sincere in their efforts to spread the gospel, I suggest the gesture is predicated on a few factors. First, at least in the pre-internet days, it assumed people knew what the referent John 3:16 was. That actually does refer to a verse in the Bible. Google has perhaps changed that today. Second, it probably assumed most people don't go to church. Most people don't take the time to read even a portion of the Bible. And for most people, the four spiritual laws is about three laws too long for their attention span. And besides, none of the above can actually fit into the space of black eye. John 3:16. And third, it probably depended on a firm belief that when the prophet Isaiah said in Isaiah 55 that God's word, assuming it meant scripture, will never return void, that it will accomplish what God desires. God probably had something like this in mind, where the curious victim will look up the verse and salvation endorphins would be released. Now, part of me gets it. Full confession. It is probably the first verse I put to memory. For God so loved the world that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. And to be on the safe side, I suppose, I memorized it in King James Version. It's a good verse. It promotes a God of love. We may not always be sure what to make of the actions of God in the Old Testament, but this verse is clear. God sent his son not to condemn the world, the following verse says, but to save the world through him. God loves us. He's pursuing us. Not a bad message to share. Second, it holds out the hope of everlasting life. always welcome. And third, from a Christian tradition point of view, it neatly separates the whosoever believes from the whosoever doesn't believe. And finally, if you're looking for an apologetic reason to single out John 3:16, it separates a German liberal theology that emerged during the late 19th century in search of the historical Jesus from a 20th century evangelical tradition which believes absolutely that the historical Jesus is indeed the Christ, the Son of God. Full stop. In effect, John 3:16 became the equivalent, the evangelical equivalent, of Luther's 99 theses on the Wittenberg door, but this time in three words. Whosoever believeth Jesus. And it is precisely here that sometimes we slip off the rails. And before I go any further, I understand that saying anything critical about our reading of John 3:16, it's akin to saying I probably converse with the devil, who incidentally, according to James 2:19, also believes in one God and does so with trembling. Here is the problem that we live with. When modern people of faith read the word believe in John's gospel, they usually imagine some kind of propositional assent that is part of a larger belief system, a network of beliefs that are all interrelated. For example, you don't just believe in Jesus. You believe that, to put it in Paul's words, that Jesus died for your sin, he was buried, raised on the third day, and so on. And to that, depending on your tradition, we may also add some other not-so-visible connections. You believe in infant baptism or adult baptism. You believe in closed or open communion. You believe in a hierarchical authority or radical priesthood of other believers. But they're all sort of interconnected. Beliefs, in this sense, are very much territorial. As they build a wall and create boundaries. To say I believe in this means I don't believe in that. In fact, beliefs march hand in hand with non-beliefs in this usage, in a mutual self-creation. If for some reason there lacks a counter-belief, then your belief in whatever it happens to be disappears. If there were no Protestants, would there be any Catholics? It is enough to make sometimes your head ache. A year ago, almost to this day, Professor Larcia Hawkins, a tenured political science professor at Wheaton College, decided as part of her Advent devotions to don a hijab to show support for Muslims who have been under scrutiny since the mass shootings in Paris and San Bernardino, California. The college, a well-known American institution, firm in the evangelical tradition, did not say anything about the hijab, but Professor Hawkins did create a stir when she posted later on Facebook, quote, I stand in religious solidarity with Muslims because they, like me, a Christian, are people of the book. And as Pope Francis stated last week, we worship the same God. Well, the response was swift. It soon became a public event leading to perhaps, according to the president of Wheaton College, the two most tumultuous months in the history of the 156-year-old Christian institution. A spokesman representing the college responded, while Islam and Christianity are both monotheistic, we believe that there are fundamental differences between the two faiths, including what they teach about God's revelation to humanity, the nature of God, the path to salvation, and the life of prayer. To which Dr. Hawkins basically responded, I affirm, once again, because she's done it before, I affirm our statement of faith, the statement of faith of Wheaton College. I'm a Christian. I agree that Muslims and Christians believe in different ways. But we worship the same God. We pursue the same God. We may debate the merits of each of those pursuits, but we're pursuing the same God. By the end of December, a process began to have her removed, actually, from the college. It was later rescinded in January with apologies after as many as 78 faculty members came to her defense, as well as some other significant theologians. In the end, the college had a tearful reconciliation chapel, and Dr. Hawkins decided to leave the college on her own terms. However, what became clear to me as I've read this particular debate and the painful episode in the history of Wheaton College was that both sides seemed to be talking past each other. For Wheaton, the line in the sand was a certain set of beliefs that clearly left Islam on this side of the line and Christianity on the other side. For Professor Hawkins, in our walk with God, while we have learned to trust a different construct of God, that does not mean that we pursue or we worship a different God. The key word here is the word worship. And to fully understand and appreciate this, we need a brief understanding of Judaism. Search all you might, and you will not find anywhere in the New Testament anyone asking Jesus, "What must I believe to be saved?" It's just not there. No, in fact, Jesus is asked on at least two occasions, "What must I do to be saved?" That is a Hebrew question. He was asked this by a rich young ruler and a lawyer. And for our purposes, we'll follow the lawyer just for a minute. Jesus asked him, "What is written in the law? What do you read there?" He answered, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself." Two passages of scripture from the Old Testament. And he said, Jesus said to him, "You've given the right answer. Ding! Do this and live. Love God and love your neighbor." Now that's worth putting on a billboard. And I suggest if your belief system does not support that, you might need to modify your belief system. The Hebrew tradition is about living the faith. But someone might say, the text says, "Whosoever believes in him," and I agree. But it does not say, "Whosoever has a belief in him." It says, "Whosoever believes in him." This is a very Johannine way of talking. In John 6:35, we read, "I am the bread of life," Jesus is talking. "Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." While written in Greek, it portrays a very Hebrew way of writing with parallel phrasing. This verse is not two separate points. Hungry and thirsty stand in for each other, and so do believe and come to me in this sense. What does it mean to believe for John? It is not a propositional affirmation. It means to come to him. Or in the synoptic tradition, it means to follow Jesus. And to put an exclamation on this point, another verse from the Johannine corpus, 1 John chapter 1, verse 23, and this is what God says we must do. Not believe, we must do. And then he uses believe on the name of Jesus Christ and love one another. Do this. Believing is doing. It is coming as you are and following along the way in our journals. Yes, we may share and compare this with what I have come to believe about Jesus. One final thought. Job had a very firm belief system. Actually, he began with the same belief system as his so-called friends in the book of Job. Behave, do good, believe in the right stuff about God, and all will be well. And it worked both ways, of course. Misbehave, don't believe the right things about God, and bad things will happen. Then, of course, in the book itself, the Satan comes along and says to God, "Take away his reliance on the system and see what happens." By force of circumstance, we're told Job loses faith in the system, but surprisingly keeps faith in God, trusting indeed that he has a witness and a redeemer in the end. Now at the end, when Job finally has his audience with God, God doesn't really give him a new belief system. Really didn't need it. He trusted God to the very end. But God comes out of the whirlwind tells him to stand up, and takes him on a tour of the horizon. And asks Job, tell me, have you entered into the springs of the sea or walked the recess of the deep? Have you comprehended the expanse of the earth? Tell me if you know any of this, or am I boring you? He moves Job out of the shelter of his belief system to the horizon that never sits still, that never sits in one place, and invites him to live with him, believing in wonder. Thank you.